The observer. What does being an observer mean? An observer is someone who watches or pays attention to something. A person who watches what happens but has no active part in it. What is the best synonyms for observer?
Spectator.
Viewer.
Witness.
Onlooker.
Bystander.
Watcher.
Eyewitness.
Non-alcoholics may attend open meetings as observers.
Open and closed meetings. I will bet you right now, if we went around this room, we would get a lot of different opinions about what an open and closed meeting is. If we took out the blue card and read that, that's also an opinion. That is not conference-approved literature. The AA group pamphlet says clearly, closed meetings are for AA members only, comma, or those who have a drinking problem and, I want to stress end, have a desire to stop drinking. When I run into someone who's willing to tell a newcomer, well, you can go to the closed meeting, just say you have a desire to stop drinking. That's only half of the spiritual requirement found in this conference-approved literature. You don't just get to, that's not like jacks are better in poker. You don't just get to say, that's not your opening hand, I have a desire to stop drinking. Not for a closed meeting. Doesn't mean you need to know you're an alcoholic. But do you have a drinking problem? Open meeting says open meetings are available to anyone interested in the Alcoholics Anonymous program of recovery from alcoholism. Non-alcoholics may attend open meetings as observers. Non-alcoholics may attend open meetings as observers. In other words, open meetings are not all Addictions Anonymous meetings. Open and closed had to do with anonymity. That's where it all started. That if you were a member, you could come to a meeting if it was declared closed, and you would know that the only other people there are other people who are either members of AA or had a drinking problem and a desire to stop drinking. Because your anonymity is yours, and you're entitled to handle it as you want. Open meetings, lots of people could be there. People that don't know they're alcoholic. People that want to listen a little. Family members. Al-Anon members. Professionals. Nurses. Students. Anyone can come to an open meeting. But as an observer. Not as a participant. That's like one of those good words to look up in the dictionary. Observer. It's very clear in every dictionary I look at that participate is not in the definition of observing. Observing, unfortunately, and listen, for new people, the hardest thing to do is to listen, right? Because they hear in so many other places, share about your problems, right? Instead of share your mess with your sponsor and bring the solution to the meeting, because they've heard things other places. So the AA group pamphlet is great for that. And then on page 18, which maybe is the most controversial. But I laugh because how could it be controversial? I know at least two other past delegates or current delegates are in this room besides myself. If you've been to the General Service Conference, the one thing you know is it's not easy to change our literature. It's not easy to create new literature. It's not easy to put your favorite edit in. So when something gets in here, it's pretty significant that AA as a whole has said this is our group conscience. And on page 18, it says the following. The primary purpose of any AA group is to carry the AA message to alcoholics. Experience with alcohol is one thing all AA members have in common. It is misleading to hint or give the impression that AA solves other problems or knows what to do about drug addiction. I'm going to read that one more time. The primary purpose of any AA group is to carry the AA message to alcoholics. Experience with alcohol is one thing all members have in common. It is misleading to hint or give the impression that AA solves other problems or knows what to do about drug addiction. And the long form of tradition three, first sentence, our membership ought to include all who suffer from alcoholism, period. What I think those two sections mean, which is here where I get branded the liberal, is that if you have alcoholism, you belong here. I don't care what anyone else says. That's what I just read. You belong here. I'm waiting to meet the alcoholic. I always joke around, but maybe I met one today in Prescott, Arizona. Is there anyone here who suffers from alcoholism who has no other problems? Okay. And I don't say that so that we'll just laugh and say that we're all addictions anonymous. That's not why I say that. I say that because the first line is very clear. Our membership ought to include all those who suffer from alcoholism, period. Meaning, we don't care what other problems you have. We care about one thing. Are you an alcoholic? Or are you someone with a drinking problem and has a desire to stop drinking? If you are that, welcome. Your other problems are none of our business. Now, Bill writes in other literature, have those other problems seem to be helped by the 12 steps? Absolutely, if you're an alcoholic. If you're an alcoholic and can come into a home group of Alcoholics Anonymous.
Sobriety, freedom from alcohol, through the teaching and practice of the 12 steps is the sole purpose of an AA group. Groups have repeatedly tried other activities, and they have always failed. It has also been learned that there is no possible way to make non-alcoholics into AA members. We have to confine our membership to alcoholics, and we have to confine our AA groups to a single purpose. If we don't stick to these principles, we shall almost surely collapse. And if we collapse, we cannot help anyone.
If we took out the blue card and read that, that's also an opinion. That is not conference-approved literature.
This is an open meeting of Alcoholics Anonymous. We are glad you're all here, especially newcomers. In keeping with our singleness of purpose in our third tradition, which states that the only requirement for AA membership is the desire to stop drinking, we ask that all who participate confine their discussion to their problems with alcohol. This is a closed meeting of Alcoholics Anonymous. In support of AA singleness of purpose, attendance at closed meetings is limited to persons who have a desire to stop drinking. If you think you have a problem with alcohol, you are welcome to attend this meeting. We ask that when discussing our problems, we confine ourselves to those problems as they relate to alcoholism. Open AA meeting. Open meetings are available to anyone interested in Alcoholics Anonymous program of recovery from alcoholism. Non-alcoholics may attend open meetings as observers. Closed AA meeting. Closed meetings are for AA members only or for those who have a drinking problem and have a desire to stop drinking. Now, those two descriptions for the open and closed meeting came directly from AA.org, which is the General Service Office for Alcoholics Anonymous. This headquarters is in New York, and this is directly from Alcoholics Anonymous. Open meetings. Non-alcoholics may attend open meetings as observers, meaning addict came to the meeting and he says, "Hi everybody, I'm so-and-so addict," and then actually starts reading the preamble or how it works or giving comments. That's not appropriate. Observers don't speak or share at an open meeting of Alcoholics Anonymous. They simply observe as visitors. Tradition 3, short form. The only requirement for AA membership is a desire to stop drinking. Tradition 3, long form. Our membership ought to include all who suffer from alcoholism. Hence, we may refuse none who wish to recover, nor ought AA membership ever depend upon money or conformity. Any two or three alcoholics gathered together for sobriety may call themselves an AA group, provided that, as a group, they have no other affiliation. This is from the book Alcoholics Anonymous, The Doctor's Opinion. The action of alcohol on these chronic alcoholics is a manifestation of an allergy, that the phenomenon of craving is limited to this class and never occurs in the average temperate drinker. That's from Dr. Silkworth and The Doctor's Opinion. And he just gave you a definition of an alcoholic. The manifestation of an allergy, the phenomenon of physical craving. Once an alcoholic puts alcohol in their body, they physically crave it. And that differentiates the alcoholic from the social drinker. Average temperate drinker or social drinker never craves alcohol.
Now we're running into what we call the dual purpose group. And we're running into this question of what we're going to do with people who have related problems. I've got a hell of a queer sex problem, I say. Or we got a divorce problem. Or we got a narcotics problem. Or we got a gambling problem. Or we're too fat. Or we're nervous. We've got an erotic problem. Well, around in AA, we got people with all those problems. I guess I got all of them myself. However, I am a drunk and you're a drunk. So the primary basis of my identification as you is the hell of a time I had drinking and the wonderful time I've had getting over. Which has involved, however, with dealing with some of these underlying problems which we already had. So now, as you know, there have been a great many sort of offshoots or copies of AA, some faithful facsimiles, some not so much so. We have Neurotics Anonymous and Gamblers Anonymous and Addicts Anonymous and Narcotics Anonymous and Divorcees Anonymous. And we have some organizations that deal with mental cases like Recovery Incorporated, and We Are Not Alone Society, and some of these people begin to do very well, and they're borrowed from. Now, some of our members go over to these other people to help them and to be helped. And that is fine. But now, again, comes the old problem that we had with the clubs, with the families, with the education. Now, we want to be married. So, let's say I'm a narcotic addict as well as an alcoholic. Well, we got around in AA a lot of people who had trouble not only with pills, but with morphine. I mean, a genuine addict They identified with us, they joined us because they were also alcoholics. But naturally, having had the addiction problem, they know the awful agony of that. They want to carry this message to the pure, straight addict. So, in some cases, they've tried to bring those people to AA meetings and bring them into full membership. Well, right away, the wheels begin to grind, because are we going to take on all of the world's problems, and can anybody with a problem join AA? No, we decided long ago AA was for a drunk. No matter what complications a drunk has and how many other problems, we don't care anything about that. The only thing we want to know is, you're drunk, you want to get over. And we'll stick to that. But now comes the guy with a current narcotic problem, and he comes to an AA group, and he says, well, I want to belong. Well, under group autonomy, this group can really do about as it likes. You can say to them, well, we only deal with alcoholics here. Or you can say to them, well, look, you can come and sit in an open meeting, and maybe you'll find a few friends around who've also had a narcotic problem who can help you start a narcotics group. Or maybe we're going to put you up on the platform and let you give a narcotic testimony, and we're going to put you on the committee, and we're going to take you right in. Well, this last mention, of course, just doesn't work very well. Because if a straight narcotic, let me say, is to become an AA member, he has to be capable of doing AA 12-step work. He has to be capable of doing AA committee work, and he has to be capable of making an AA pitch from a platform, and how the hell can he if he's a narcotic? He can't. So that it is my hope that where there are good-sized open meetings, that AA members who themselves have had a narcotic experience and wish to work with narcotics should certainly be permitted to bring these people in as visitors to get fixed, with the idea that they may be able to start their own group. But I don't see how we can go any further with that. And the group is the last word on the subject, though. The group can do what it likes. Now then, the question comes, if you've got, in an institution, let's say, you've got a peculiar condition where they can't have but one meeting a week, the AA group, and here are a lot of narcotic people, and here are people with just a plain crime problem and other problems, and they see these drunks getting so much better emotionally, and say, how do you do it? And you go to the warden, and maybe the group goes to the warden and says, well, can't these other people come to our meeting? Or can't they have separate meetings, and can't we help them out? The warden says, no, you can't have separate meetings. You just have one meeting a week. And it would be great if you'd have these people in. Or I'm telling you, I'm putting them there. So, okay. So in comes a guy with a sex problem, with a narcotic problem, with a burglary problem, or whatever it is. And he sits down with the AA group in the meeting. Well, I say, what up? The only thing that that group must do is to say, we're the AA neurotic group, or we are the AA burglary group, see? If that group is going to be listed in the directory as an AA group, these other people have got to be visitors. Then when they go out, there isn't any guarantee that you're going to receive a guy who was just a plain yegg that never drank any grog. Maybe he would be received as an open meeting, maybe not. I don't know. I think that's up to each group. Now, you see, there are these borderline cases, which are not matters of shifting the AA tradition around. It's just a reasonable application. And again, it's this middle course. You can take the course. We'll have nothing to do with anything whatever but a drunk. A pure drunk. Well, in the first place, there ain't any pure drunk. But all these things are able to come. Or you can take the attitude, AA is going to save the world, let's bring them all in. Now, how do you apply the AA tradition of the single purpose of AA and the no-endorsement idea of AA and the group autonomy idea of AA? If you take those three traditions, you can work out fair application, which will make what we know available to these other situations and groups, and at the same time, not get us married and compromised, which might ruin us. because I think that it is a fundamental running all through government and through all forms of society that your first function is to preserve your own sanity. Let us first preserve Alcoholics Anonymous, then next let us, as individuals, do what we can for the world around us.
Hi, sir.
The observer. What does being an observer mean? An observer is someone who watches or pays attention to something. A person who watches what happens but has no active part in it. What is the best synonyms for observer? Spectator. Viewer. Witness. Onlooker. Bystander. Watcher. Eyewitness. Non-alcoholics may attend open meetings as observers. Sobriety, freedom from alcohol, through the teaching and practice of the 12 steps is the sole purpose of an AA group. Groups have repeatedly tried other activities, and they have always failed. It has also been learned that there is no possible way to make non-alcoholics into AA members. We have to confine our membership to alcoholics. And we have to confine our AA groups to a single purpose. If we don't stick to these principles, we shall almost surely collapse. And if we collapse, we cannot help anyone.